Authority. I'm Harvey Smilovitz. Thanks for turning us on tonight. We will tell you all about what you want to know about the Bengals and Ravens. The Who Asked You gang offers up unbiased analysis. You'll get the lowdown on the rest of the action around the AFC North, plus your fantasy studs, all coming up in the next 30 minutes. Hey, the Bengals, number one concern this season, you know what it is, stopping the run. They did a fine job against Miami last Sunday, but today, Jamal Lewis and the Ravens come to town. And in six games already against the Bengals, Lewis has rushed for at least 100 yards in every meeting. Let's go to Marshall Harris for today's highlights. Marshall?
Harvey, today's game against the Ravens was a crucial one for plenty of reasons. A chance for the Bengals to move above 500, a chance to start division play 1-0, a chance to finally stop Jamal Lewis, and a chance for the offense to get on track and into the end zone. Mike Williams and Ed Burkholder were at Paul Brown Stadium, and so was Rudy Johnson. 16 yards on this pickup, the longest run the Ravens have given up all season. But the drive dies and the Ravens get the ball. Jamal Lewis comes into the game with 100 yards rushing in all six games he's played against the Bengals. Off to a strong start here. 32-yard pickup into Bengals territory. He'd add 18 more on another carry. That leads to a 21-yard Matt Stover field goal and a 3-0 Ravens lead. After a couple of Bengals possessions, they're forced to punt. B.J. Sam's back to return, and he is using his blockers wisely. Beats Kevin Casevarn, a little zig here, a little zag there, and, well, he's kind of gone. 63 yards all the way down inside the 10 before Tony Stewart finally brings him down. Bengals hold on first and second down, but on third and goal from the 7, Kyle Bowler can't find anyone, so he does the dirty work himself. Races to the pylon for a 7-yard touchdown, 10-3 Ravens after one quarter. Bengals can't get anything going, but the Ravens can. Bowler dumps it off to Lewis, puts Torrey James on spinners, and Lewis is running wild down the sideline. Nate Webster can't push him out. A 46-yard pickup takes the Ravens down inside the 40. Second and 7 from the 21. Bowler on play action sees nothing but green ahead, sprints to the end zone, but before he can get there, Nate Webster pops him and pops the ball loose. Torrey James recovers in the end zone to save a touchdown. Carson Palmer in the offense, though, not exactly productive early. Palmer thinking big play, looking for Chad Johnson deep. Instead, it's Ed Reed with the pick, but he's not done there. Returns it 40 yards. He picked Palmer twice, racked up 90 yards return on the process. Gives the Ravens good field position here. Bowler then takes advantage. The strike to Randy Hines, and, well, he can take care of the rest. Beats James and runs past Kevin Hardy. A 38-yard touchdown. Bowler 11 for 18, 126 yards on the score. Bengals looking at a 17-0 hole. Just before the half, the Bengals finally start to roll. Third and 11 from the 28. Palmer to Kelly Washington. Pickup of 17 and a first down. The Bengals get a 29-yard field goal from Shane Graham. 17-3 Ravens at the half. Now 17-6, fourth quarter. After another Palmer pick, the Bengals get it right back. Kyle Bowler can't hold on to the ball. Webster recovers. Bengals turn it into points. A 26-yard field goal from Graham, and it's 17-9. Bengals now with momentum. Jamal Lewis swings it back the Ravens' way in a hurry. Justin Smith can't hold on, and no one else can catch up. 75 yards to pay dirt. Lewis with 232 yards total, 186 rushing on 18 carries after a failed two-point conversion. Ravens up 23-9. Palmer trying to get the Bengals into the end zone. Hooks up with TJ here for 19 all the way down to the 17. Hushman Zada with 7 catches for a career-high 116 yards. 4th and 18 from the 25. Bengals go for it. Palmer can't find a receiver, but Marcus Douglas finds him. One of 4 Ravens sacks. Palmer finishes 25 of 52 for 316 yards and 3 picks, and on the short end of a 23-9 loss. That's 2 games now the Bengals have gone without scoring an offensive touchdown. Inside the locker room, Marvin Lewis talked about Carson Palmer and his entire team's inability to consistently move the chains.
We made too many critical errors today. You know, he didn't give himself a chance to be successful. He had some fine throws and some fine plays, but then we can't throw the ball up in the middle of the field trying to make something out of nothing. You know, we had if he's on the run, let's keep the ball in there at the end there. He just doesn't see the guy. I mean, we know that's not his best football game. Carson Palmer, a lot better football player than what he showed out here today.
Made a couple of dumb decisions. One of them got real greedy on. Just didn't have anything open. And you know, that's one of the things I really got to fight, especially early, being a young quarterback, is you get greedy and you got to fight the temptation. You feel like you're down a lot. You got to make something happen. You need a big play, and you do something stupid like that.
The goal is to score points, more points than them, and we didn't score more points. So that's the area which we need improvement in. But I think our total yards were there. It's just we had to find a way to get our playmakers into the end zone, and that starts with everybody, the O-line, quarterbacks, receivers, and running backs.
Well, we still got high expectations, man. Nothing has changed. You know, we're still the same team. You know, we got a lot of guys down, so we're going to rally around those guys, play for our fallen teammates, and just get this thing back on track, man. So we'll be fine, man.
Time to hand out our game ball, and it goes to TJ Houzmanzadeh. 7 catches are just 2 off his personal best, and for the first time, he goes over the 100-yard mark with 116. Add in another 39 yards on kick returns. Harvey, I think it's time to hear what the fans have to say.
Marshall, thank you very much. Tonight, you at home, make the call. What is most disappointing about the loss to the Ravens? Is it the run defense, the pass protection, the poor tackling, or do you believe something else? Pick up the phone now. Call us at 345-1212. Lines are open. I want your vote. We'll have your results a little later in the show. Now, following today's game, the voice of the Bengals, Brad Johansen, went under the helmet with one of the Bengals' leading tacklers, defensive end Dwayne Clemens.
I know Marvin Lewis is going to say we simply have to tackle better. Is it more simple than that?
Yeah, pretty much. I mean, I think we had a solid scheme, and a lot of times we had guys there. So, you know, when it came to him being a big, powerful, strong guy, you know, sometimes it was a mismatch. You know, you had guys that were smaller than him trying to fill a gap. And, you know, when that guy gets a full head of steam and gets to run downhill at you, then, you know, it's just really hard to tackle him.
I know that was preached all week long. We have to stop Jamal Lewis. He gets out on his first one for 32 yards. He runs for his second one for 18 yards, 50 yards and 2 carries, and he breaks one on a missed tackle in the backfield for 75 yards. Do you chalk it up to experience and say we simply have to do it better the next time?
Absolutely. I mean, we know we've had games here. We held them to 65 last year, so we know what we have to do. We've done it before. It's just, you know, today he had a great day, and, you know, sometimes great backs are going to have great days, and, you know, we have to come back, make our adjustments, you know, forget about it after Monday and then get ready for Pittsburgh.
You have 3 games running in the division right now. You lose the first one at home. The next 2 come on the road. I know it's kind of ridiculous to say there's a crucial game at game 4 in the season, but has it become crucial going into the bye week that you have to get a win in Pittsburgh?
I think every game in the NFL is crucial. You know, I remember, you know, it becomes a rerun in the sense that every preseason game is crucial. Every snap in practice is crucial. Every moment you spend preparing for a game is crucial. So I don't think there's ever a point where nothing matters.
Injuries continue to pile up. Nate goes down, Levi goes down. You had so many guys going into this game. You probably had more down than you could put down today. Have you run through a team like this where it has been so rampant early on in the season where you've dealt with so many injuries?
No, this has probably been one of the most difficult situations I've ever seen of any team I've ever been on, where we've had so many key guys in this position where they might not be ready or they're battling through injuries and trying to play.
Can you share at all what Marvin Lewis shared with the team in final analysis?
I mean, you know, it's the same thing we always preach. You know, you got one day to feel bad about this, and after Monday, you know, we're going to go in and make our adjustments, and then you forget about it. You know, every experience is not going to be a positive one, but sometimes you learn more from the negative than you do from the positive, especially early in the season, because, you know, right now we're looking at the big picture, and the big picture is we got to have a great season, and this is just 1 week.
Guys, thank you very much. Still to come, a look at the rest of the action from around the AFC North. But up next, our analysts are in studio to break down the big game. It's Who Asked You? Stay with us. Analysis courtesy of our football experts. And I'm willing to bet they have an opinion on our poll question tonight. Let's toss it over to Brad at the Bengals set for Who Asked You? Oh, Brad.
Harvey, thank you very much. Along with Richard Skinner, 1360 Homer, the sports animal, and I'm throw a little Turfway plug your way as well for this one. Joe Walther in, also former Bengal. Gentlemen, this was not a fun one to watch. Before we get to the real in-depth stuff, let's talk about our poll question. You guys want to weigh in? What disappoints you the most? Do you have an option?
There's an A and B and a C. Can I go with D?
You want to go with other?
All the above?
All
the
above.
All the above?
And then something else and list 4 more?
I got to say rush defense. If you're asking me to pick one, rush defense, because they played 2 legitimate running teams and one of the worst offensive lines in all of football in the Dolphins. So, I'm glad they dominated the Dolphins like they did, but let's not get too excited because that's a bad team.
You came back to reality today?
Yeah, today was an easy comeback to reality because they faced 2 good rushing teams, and the 2 good rushing teams have averaged 200 yards. That's now, and you go back to last year too, Brad, the last handful of games. I believe now, and I'm throwing Miami out of the mix. If you throw Miami out of the mix, I think they've now given up 1,200 yards in their last 6 games against legitimate opponents.
I'm with you on this. As an offensive lineman, are you going to pick something different or go along that same line?
I want to go along the same line. I was really disappointed today, on the way they played, the way the front 7 played. There was no tackling. I mean, it's really A and D for me. Both are together in that whole thing. But, yeah, it was just a poor, poor outing for our defense, and I don't see it ever getting better this year.
As you go into this, there was a tease a little bit in the second half to the point where they were driving to a point to bring it within a three-point game, and yet this team was not able to make plays. Give me an overall on Carson Palmer's performance today with as much as they had guys in his face.
C-minus, and maybe even I could give it a flat C. I mean, the guy made a couple of really bad throws. The throw down the middle for the interception, the second Edwitt Reed interception was just a bad, bad decision that he made. But, you know, you're also down 17-0 trying to play catch-up in part because you don't tackle, in part because special teams were bad. And I'm sorry, this kid's not ready to play catch-up yet at this level. It'll happen one day, but it's not going to happen in game three of his NFL career.
And you?
I'm going to go C minus. I think that's where I'm going to go. I think I should really back that up. I'm going to say C minus for Carson. I'm going to say D for the offensive line. Our offensive line was supposed to be our strength of the team going into this season. Yeah, we're banged up and we've got some guys hurt, but the guys that are coming in should be able to pick up the pace. They've been there. We've got some veteran guys playing backup, and we're still getting a lot of pressure on Carson. And the kid just got pummeled today.
And to pony off that, I mean, you know, a lot of the comments after last week where Jerry Fontenot really started to get it. They started to clean up as the game went along. And then, unfortunately, to backtrack today was disappointing in that regard.
Tell me, as you're watching in an offensive line, because I know when my partner in the booth is constantly watching technique, what's going on with this offensive line?
I think right now I don't know if it's technique. It is technique. I think the two tackles are opening up right away, especially Levi. He was struggling all day. He's been doing it the last couple of games. I'm sure Paul's addressed it. If he hasn't, he needs to address it because he's opening the gate right away, right out of the stands. But I think most of the problem with our offensive line is technique right now. They're just not, they don't look good technique. They don't look sharp technique-wise. They're not moving the ball. Their footwork doesn't look good. They're turning their shoulders. They're opening the gate up for Carson.
How is a team that prides itself on its guru, a defensive guru, have such problems, and not week in and week out, but on many weekends, tackling?
That part's interesting to me because I would have thought they'd be a better tackling team, and maybe it just comes down to the personnel isn't good enough. Now, you would think NFL personnel could tackle, but, you know, it goes hand in hand. If you're not athletic enough to play the position, you're reaching and grabbing and grabbing and reaching instead of tackling. And, you know, I do wonder this. While Marvin's not the GM, he still makes a lot of personnel decisions, and I started thinking about this today, and it goes back to when Rick Pitino was in Boston. Rick Pitino, the GM personnel guy, didn't do Rick Pitino, the coach, any favors. And to me, Marvin, the personnel guy, with some of the moves he's made personnel-wise, and he's been the front man, so I've got to hold him accountable for him, I'm not sure he's helped Marvin Lewis, the coach, in that regard. And I think all that comes back to...
You want to go specific on any of those?
Well, I mean, right now, Kevin Hardy in 2 years has not overwhelmed me. Nate Webster still continues to underwhelm me a ton.
Well, seeing Nate Webster in a scooter in the locker room afterwards, although Marvin doesn't like to talk about injuries, gives you an indication Nate Webster may be gone for a while.
And that's a factor, too, because you really don't have a lot of backups. You know, the rookies to this point, Madu Williams has at least played, and Landon Johnson and Caleb have played a little bit, but, you know, the tackles haven't played much. You know, Matthias Askew, I thought, was at least going to get some reps in there and at least provide something. He has not done that. And so, you know, I have to hold Marvin, the personnel guy, a little bit accountable for this.
Okay, you're talking about the Bengals playing two really, really good defenses.
True.
I don't care whether you're playing two really, really good defenses. You have to score points in eight quarters. What's the reason that this offense that was going to be explosive can't score points?
Well, I think the number one thing is right now is we're not getting any protection on Carson, and we're not getting any movement on the front in the front seven there. There's no ball movement at all. Rudy hasn't had any big runs of late. If he does, it's 10-15 yards, which, yeah, it's a big run, but we're used to the Corey Dillons of the world taking it and going the distance, and we're not getting that right now.
And it's that consistent 4, 5, 6 yard. You know, he'll get the 15-yard, but then he'll get the one, the two, and that adds
nothing.
Up to not a
nothing.
Great day.
So what needs to change then? Are you saying that the personnel on both – you're saying on both sides of the ball, maybe coming back to reality, the personnel's not as good as you thought?
I think a lot of it – I mean, we're beating these guys up right now, but you've got to also remember in the back of our head – he's wanting to take a youth movement here. So we've got a lot of young guys on both sides of the ball playing, mixed in with veteran types. Whether the veteran types are the right mix, if they're doing the leadership that they have to be doing, I don't know. But you got to kind of back up and say, okay, we knew going into this thing you're going to start a second-year quarterback that really hasn't had any playing time until now. He's doing a fabulous job with what he's so far out there.
Very quickly, is it fair to say that this has to be the only home loss of the season if you're going to be a playoff-bound team? And is Pittsburgh a must-game?
I think it's darn close to a must-game. And, yeah, Because going into the year, I could make a case, Brad, that they could lose every road game, and I could have made a case they could win every home game. Well, that case can't be made anymore because they've lost a home game. This team isn't good enough yet, and because of the youth that Joe's talking about, it can't go on the road and win more than two or three football games. So you better go 7-1, at very worst 6-2 at home.
As a player, is this a must game now for you?
Oh, it's a big time must game. You've got to win this game going into the bye to have some momentum going into the bye week.
Gentlemen, thanks for coming in. Appreciate it. Harvey, we will send it back to you.
Brad, thank you very much. For more on the Bengals, log on to WKRC.com and check out our Bengals Nation. And while you're there, vote on the poll questions and post a line or two on the message board, Local 12. You made the call, now the results. We asked what is most disappointing about the loss to the Ravens, and it's pretty close. 32% go for poor tackling, 29% run defense, 28% pass protection. Thanks if you're one of the more than 300 callers who phoned us here tonight.
They couldn't stop the run. Jamal Lewis, Marshall Faulk, Lee Suggs, they all topped the 100-yard mark with ease. And in three games this season, Curtis Martin and Lewis have done it again. The solution? It's not rocket science.
I mean, we just got to tackle. It's plain and simple. I mean, we can't invent new defenses, you know, to stop people. We got people there, we got to make tackles. It's plain and simple.
A little bit of it is a want to and a desire, and that's part of it. I think that's, you know, that part of it, it's hard to – You have to go back and take a critical look at that. Yes, we have to take a look at that, no question about it. Because when you're there and you don't make it, you know, now you're telling me something too.
Linebacker Nate Webster is out for Sunday's game at Pittsburgh, likely done for the year. He had surgery to repair a torn tendon in his knee this morning. Webster suffered the injury late in the fourth quarter yesterday. Now, with backup Caleb Miller still hobbled by a bad ankle, Adrian Ross was flown in from California for a workout today. But the free agent told me after that workout, the Bengals sent him home